seaside.
Buenos dias. Okay. So this last week we had our education program launch and all the classes started. So just in case you didn't know, here's a little reminder. On Tuesdays, this is the last Tuesday that you can join Reverend Christian's foundation class, Foundation Science of Mind. It's for Tuesday, January 16th, from 6:30 to 9:15. And on Thursdays, if you've already taken foundations, you are welcome to take Essential Earnest with Dr. Kathy Hearn and with me and my friends. We are all there from 6:30 to 9 o'clock. That's on Thursdays. If you are interested in enrichment classes, we have Carrie Lake, who is teaching sensory awareness workshop tools to revitalize the body. Wow. This is on Monday. This is tomorrow, January 15th, 6:30 to 8:30. And then we have Karen Copeland's class, Are You Ready for Unabashed Joy? It's on Saturdays, and it's still open, so join her this Saturday, the 20th, to upgrade your life from ho-hum to wahoo. That's the name. And then we have the Spiritual Mind Treatment Workshop, which is coming up with practitioner Ginny Mills on Saturday, on January 27th. So do yourself a favor and sign up for a class to kick off a fabulous new year. On Saturday, January 20th, we have Callie Holmes Sorensen, who is leading the women in the Women's March. There will be a charter bus from Encinitas going all the way down to San Diego to join in the march. We will unite in San Diego to reaffirm our commitment to building a positive and just future for all, and to celebrate the spirit of resistant efforts over the past year. This march is designated to engage and empower voters to support women's rights, human rights, social and environmental justice, and to encourage participation in 2018 midterm elections. So you can see Callie, she has a table in the back left corner if you want to talk to Callie about that after service. I'm almost done. January 21st, we have Dances for Universal Peace starting at 7 o'clock. January 28th, we have annual community meeting at 12:30. February 5th, we have a deep sound meditation. Those are amazing. You always want to bring a little pillow because the floor gets a little hard when you're laying down for a long time, and a little blanket because you get a little cold. February 11th, renewal of vows between services. And this Wednesday, we have Power Up Wednesday night at 7 p.m., and we have Amy Steinberg. If you guys were here when we had Kyle Cease here and you saw that amazing singer, she's going to be singing and she will be doing a talk. So it's a powerful Wednesday. It's a powerful week. There's so many things going on. Get tuned in. We always need volunteers. If you want to help, we have the bookstore, and then there is the social media marketing team with me, and then you get to, you know, converse with me and have fun conversations. So all of that being said, you may stand up, greet your neighbor.
Good morning, everybody. Let's all stay standing together and sing You Are the Light this morning.
You are the light of
right. Sounding good, Danielle. Thank you. And good morning, Seaside. Woo, what a joy it is to be with you on this fabulous day. It is an exciting day here at Seaside as we go back to the basics, just the basic principles of our philosophy. And I got to tell you right up front, one of them is to put spirit first always. And one of the things we do here at Seaside is we have a practitioner sit in our prayer center throughout the whole service, doing what we call is holding the light, just being that conduit through which that spirit flows. We have a wonderful practitioner today. That is Ed Cox, who is holding the light and will be walking back to our wonderful prayer center. And know that he is available along with other practitioners after the service right in that corner if you want personal prayers. They are available to you. So, hey, wherever you are on your spiritual path, know that you are in the perfect place. You are welcome here. It's fun to see some of you back who I haven't seen in a while. But it's the new year. That happens every year. It's like we see if we got longevity with this because Seaside is growing. It is expanding. It is rocking because we continue to take our spiritual principles to those relevant areas in our life. So wherever you are, you're welcome here. It is a place that is loving, caring, affirming, and just honoring you. And who you are is going to make a difference as to how this morning unfolds. And so to bring us in with a little bit more prayer is a wonderful practitioner. We've got Katie. She has this huge consciousness. Come on forward. She has worked in the ministry of prayer for more than 20 years, praying 8 hours a day, every day. And just to be in her field, healing happens. So take it away.
Thank you and good morning. So we just move into that vibration of the bell and we allow it to carry us forward into the knowingness and the acceptance that all there is God, that there is that divine loving presence of God blessing me, blessing each and every one of us individually and collectively. We have come together to recognize the truth of this good, that we are all one in that oneness. And I know that as I go forward speaking this word, I speak it from the place of total truth, total faith, total knowingness. I know that there is that loving grace of God blessing and guiding and directing us in all of our activities each and every day. And the activities of today is this that we call Seaside Center for Spiritual Living. We are here to acknowledge it, to be part of it, to express it, to know that there's only love here. And this love radiates and vibrates throughout all things. And I know that as I speak my word for Reverend Christian, I know that he is blessed in the work that he is doing. He has already surrendered to that divine power to allow himself to be the instrument of God, to move through him and bring forth that sacred word that falls in our ears and to our heart. And we live from this place knowing that it is all good and very, very good. And I just simply release this into the law knowing it is done.
Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know. Be still and know that you are God. Be still and know that you are. Be still and know that you are God. Be still and know. Be still and know.
Thank you, Danielle, for singing us in so beautifully to remind us why we're here this morning, and our practitioner emeritus, Katie, for your beautiful prayer and consciousness. Thank you. Good morning. I'm Reverend Dr. Christina Tillotson. It's my honor to especially welcome you if you're new to Seaside, if you're new to this philosophy, this faith, this way of life. We have a special packet for you right outside the back door with all kinds of coupons and goodies for the bookstore, just to, and some CDs in there, just to show you how much we appreciate your sharing your light and your love with us today. And it's an especially appropriate day to be sharing your light and your love with us because it's Martin Luther King weekend. And of course, he taught that light and that love for all people. And this Seaside Center for Spiritual Living is part of a worldwide organization called Centers for Spiritual Living, based in Golden, Colorado, whose vision is to awaken humanity to its spiritual magnificence for a world that works for everyone. So if you can get behind that vision, you are in the right place, and your light here today makes a difference. So thank you so much for being here today. Every January, as Dr. Christian said, all the centers throughout the world talk about the basics of our philosophy, our faith, and our way of life, the science of mind. So the reading I've chosen for today is from one of my favorite books by Dr. Ernest Holmes, the founder of this philosophy. It's called Your Invisible Power. It's out of print right now, and it was given many years ago to people who were donating to the Science of Mind Foundation. But I love this book because it just keeps giving. And every January, I look at all kinds of other things to read, and I keep coming back to this one. So you've heard this one before, but here it is again. This allness of truth, stated in the simplest manner, affirms that God is all there is. God never changes. God is in me. God is that which I am. God is in the universe. God is the universe. At first, man is ignorant of his true nature. The word has become flesh, but self-conscious life has not yet emerged. The fusion of will, desire, and volition, without which there can be no personality, has not taken place. Finally, the word not only becomes flesh, it also becomes person. Man awakes to life, turns toward the light, and triumphs over limitations. Therefore, our final self-evident proposition delivers the perception of bliss, wholeness, and perfection. The universal I am and the individual I am are one in peace, joy, love, wisdom, beauty, and power. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was life, and the Word was law, and the Word was light, and the light through law produced form, and the created form turned to the light, and the light of consciousness dawned, and man beheld the light and walked in it, and the light was all. So let's take these ideas into our form of affirmative prayer. So turning within to that place where I know that that light is all, that love is all, that God or spirit or the Tao or Snookum Doodles or the force, whatever one wants to call it, it is all through and as all of its creation, as love, as light, as wisdom, as power, as divine right action, continually creating universes and people and animals and cells and grains of sand out of itself every second of every sacred day. And that is who I am. And each one here is, and each one within the sound of my voice coming in through the internet is. God in human form, spirit as love, spirit as light, spirit as peace, right here and right now, sharing this sacred time together. And so I'm knowing that out of this sacred time together, that light and that love and that peace of spirit just reveals itself, that that vision of dark Dr. Martin Luther King becomes revealed and ever more real out of this time together, out of just revealing that light and that love and that peace that is the truth of all beings. And so I just gratefully accept this light, this love, this truth, and this peace as the truth of this time together right here and right now. As I release this word to the law, knowing that it is now done in perfect love, in perfect peace, in perfect harmony. And so it is. Amen.
Thank you. It's a great day here at Seaside. So good to see everyone's faces, and I was so especially happy to see this beautiful face first thing this morning. This is Carissa, you guys, and she is she's a fellow singer here in San Diego and a dear friend. She has this amazing original band together called Rosa's Cantina, and they've got a show coming up right here in your neighborhood on Saturday, January 20th at the San Dieguito Heritage Museum. All ages show. After you hear her, you are going to want to go and catch that. You are in for a treat this morning. Get ready. I know you're going to be so moved because this girl can sing. This is Carissa Schroeder.
Thank you, Danielle.
Shoes upon my feet. Sometimes I couldn't even eat. Cried myself nice to sleep. Still I had to keep on going. Never knowing if I could take it, if I could make it through the night. I held on to my faith. I struggled and I prayed. And now I found my way. If you believe in yourself enough and know what you want, you're gonna make it happen, make it happen. And if you get down on your knees at night and pray to the Lord, He's gonna make it happen, make it happen. He's gonna make it happen. Whoa, yeah. I know life can be so tough and you feel like giving up. Baby, just be strong. Just hold on. You never find the answers if you throw your life away. I used to feel the way you do. Still I have to keep on going. Never knowing if I can take it, if I can make it through the night. I held on to my faith. I struggled and I prayed. And now I found my way. If you believe in yourself enough and know what you want, you're gonna make it happen, make it happen. And if you get down on your knees at night and pray to the Lord, He's gonna make it happen, make it happen. If you believe in yourself enough and know what you want, you're gonna make it happen, make it happen. And if you get down on your knees at night and pray to the Lord, He's gonna make it happen, make it happen. He's gonna make it happen, make it happen. If you believe in yourself enough and know what you want, you're gonna make it happen, make it happen. And if you get down on your knees at night and pray to the Lord, He's gonna make it happen, make it happen. We'll make it happen, yeah. Oh, 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 yeah. Right. If you believe within your soul, just hold on tight and don't let go. You can make it. Almost was lost. And now I'm found, I got my feet on solid ground. Thank you, Lord, make it happen. Yeah, you're gonna make it happen. Whoa, yeah. And if you get down on your knees at night and pray for the Lord, He's gonna make it happen, make it happen. If you believe in yourself enough and know what you want, you're gonna make it happen, make it happen. And if you get down on your knees at night and pray to the Lord, He's gonna make it happen, make it happen.
This is Carissa Schrader. Woo! My goodness, you bet God's gonna make it happen. Danielle and Rebecca, what are you guys doing keeping Carissa from us all these years? Man, you are fabulous. Man, my whole being has been Carissa Schrader. Woo, my goodness. All right, so that's what you have been missing if you have been missing out on Seaside lately. It's just another musical morning here. Oh, wow. And Ben, man, you were red hot. Max, man, way to go. All right, so as Dr. Christina was sharing with you, the beginning of the year, what the Centers for Spiritual Living do across the country, if not the globe, is we go back to the basics. Just like a good sports team, what you do is you go back to the basics. You get these basics down, and where we go for the basics are the first four introductory chapters to Ernest Holmes' book, The Science of Mind. Now, it's like the abridged version of the whole textbook, and people used to teach The Science of Mind without doing the introductory chapters because they thought it was so complicated that you should read the whole book before you understood this. But my contention is, if Ernest didn't want you to read it first, he wouldn't have stuck it at the beginning of his book. It's like, of course, that's where you start, in the very first chapter. It's like, this is pretty fundamental stuff. But it's like, God. It all starts with God. And so those of you that are part of my foundation class this week, it's where we're going to start, is coming to that experience of that divine force, that presence, that life force, that intelligence, that all animating something, that first cause, first breath, the joy, the grace, the wisdom, that light, that energy that is moving in and through all things. It is the first breath, the first pulse, that which caused us to be. That's what we're talking about here this morning when we talk about that thing called God. And a lot of times when you mention that word God, I notice for people is there's like this chill that goes up their spine because it brings up these old concepts. Oh, no, not that. You know, it's not this anthropomorphic being sitting up in the clouds with this little book doing the checks and, oh, yeah, good, bad, not, ooh, you're in trouble now. No. It is the very essence. It is the order. It is the cause. It is the first word. It is the volition. It is the choices. That which knows itself, which is you expressing. And so Ernest Holmes' first chapter is called The Thing Itself. Right? No big deal for us, right? We call it it. You know, it, Howard, Howard be his name. You know, it doesn't matter what it is you call it, right? But if you talk to some other religions, and you're calling God an it or a thing, like the thing itself, they'll go, blasphemy. It's like, I'm not really big on this blasphemy thing. You know, it's like, I don't really believe in blasphemy unless you are putting yourself down, unless you're belittling yourself, unless you are invalidating your gifts that you came into this world to share, unless you are shooting yourself down. This blasphemy doesn't really count when we're talking about the thing itself, because it really doesn't care, whatever it is. But what I do know is when we are faced with a challenge or difficulty in our life, something that brings us to our knees, as Carissa was sharing, and gets us to pray. You know, God can make it happen. But when we are experiencing that kind of challenge, it doesn't mean that we're failing or that we're broken. It means that your spirit is wanting to be soaring, not coping, that your essence wants to be shining that light, that it wants to be flying. You want more because you are more, and because something is not working, and it doesn't mean that it's time to start doubting yourself. It is time to recognize that there's something inside of you that knows that you are more than this situation. And what you get to do is bring this thing itself into that very expression of what spirit is. It's January, so metaphorically, it's like we're standing at the threshold of, you know, a door. And, you know, it's, sometimes it's if we're on the wrong side of the door, you know, where things just, they're not working out. It's like they almost work out, but then it rains, or your ticket is taken from you, or it's not punched, or there is difficulty. You begin to question yourself, or there is this anxiety or doubt that is starting to show up for you, or the world belongs to young techies or blondes, or, you know, who knows where our fears go. Things aren't working out. You doubt it's not happening. Your lover may be a teeny bit misleading when you discover they're presently married to 6 people at this time. You know, whatever it is that is bringing up doubts for you, let you know that it is opportunity, that you're at the threshold, and you got to get across that threshold. You got to get through, step through that door. And sometimes you got to hobble through that door. Other times, you need to crawl on your belly to the other side, where all of a sudden you realize, I can think differently about this. You know, it takes courage. If you don't have courage, then it takes desperation. You know, whatever it takes, let that be the impetus that gets you through to the other side, where all of a sudden you realize, you know what, things can be differently when I choose to think differently, when I choose to allow that spirit to move through me in a way that is empowering, that is not blasphemy against my great God self, because spirit needs me. Ooh, boy, that's kind of blasphemy in some places. But without you, this infinite potential just remains potential. Yeah. It needs a channel, an avenue, a conduit, a place to move into form. And that is where you have been called in here. And with this, you can begin to recognize that I can bring forth things differently in my life. I've got to be the superhero in my life. But if I want my life different, then I'm the one who's got to be willing to free myself from the challenges and the difficulties that my mind believes are so true. These circumstances. You know, Ernest Holmes writes in his book, The Science of Mind, which has become our textbook. And on the very first page, the very first chapter, so once again, I think he feels that's important. He uses the word freedom. For me, that is like the key of what this is all about. It is freedom. From whatever is going on in my life that I don't like, it is freedom to be able to create what it is I want. He uses the word freedom 6 times in one paragraph. If I ever used the same word 6 times in one paragraph, my teacher would have failed me. But Ernest, he's got a whole way of thinking based upon the word freedom that he uses on the first page of the first chapter of his book, The Science of Mind, that I have so diligently marked for all of us. And here we go. He said, individuality, it must be spontaneous, without leaving one to discover himself. Let me start over here. I jumped all over. Individuality must be spontaneous. It can never be automatic. The seed of freedom must be planted in the innermost being. The divine plan is one of freedom. Bondage is not God-ordained. Freedom is the birthright of every living soul, and all instinctively feel this, for the truth points to freedom under the law. The one inherent nature is forever seeking to express itself in terms of freedom. We would do well to listen to this inner voice, for it tells us of a life that is wonderful in its scope, of a love beyond our fondest dreams, and of a freedom which the soul craves. Pretty clear. It's about freedom. And if all of a sudden the circumstances you find yourself in, you find them discouraging and challenging, it is up to you to get that little higher view and say, you know, the thing itself is far greater than this, and it's looking to express itself through me, and I've got to be willing to step to a higher place and begin to be that superhero, that courageous one that is saying, you know what, I'm going to speak differently, I'm going to see things differently because I want my life to be different. If you keep doing the same thing you've been doing, what'd they say? That's crazy. You're insane. It doesn't work. If you want to expand and if you want to grow, you've got to be courageous enough to be willing to do something different, because there's people, I got to tell you, it seems like their life is always working. You ever notice them? They're always happy. It doesn't matter the circumstances. It's like they're always happy. They have got this creative angle. They're always figuring something new out. They're always getting the funds. They do the GoFundMe, and everybody jumps on it to support it. You know, they have got the creative ideas. They are making the right connections. They are finding the perfect partner. They are finding the love. And it is because, there it is, they have mastered the aspect of bringing that love to their life. They have mastered the aspect of bringing that presence of God into their world. They have been willing to take a look at the challenges that are there and recognize that the obstacles in their path are their path, that it is their path. What's the saying? You know, the challenges that are in your way, it is the way. That is what we get to move through. That is what we get to walk through. And every choice that you are given is the universe inviting you to remember who you are. That's good. Remember that, okay? Everything you got going on, a choice you get to make, is the universe inviting you to remember who you are in that situation and in every situation of your life. There was this, I would say old-time preacher, but it's 1800s, that's a given. Anyway, Stopford Brooks, and he was an Irish preacher who said, if 1,000 beliefs fail on your march to truth, you must continue to march in truth no matter what. If 1,000 beliefs fail on your march to truth, you've got to remember to continue that march, that truth. If things are starting to change, if things are starting to shift, and that's what you wanted to go on in your world, is things to increase and enhance, and they're starting to happen, you've got to continue that march of that vision that is calling you forward, that is calling you into the greater situation, because those circumstances that are going on, that can be a challenge, they don't define you. You get to redefine them because you're the storyteller of your life. And if you're coming from a mountaintop view, if you're coming from a higher place, if you're coming from the thing itself, you're able to perceive your life in a new kind of way. So, there's this couple. They've been married for more than 60 years. They loved each other. They'd done everything together. They trusted. They held nothing from one another except there was this one shoebox that this little old lady, she had. She had it from the day they got married, and she told her husband-to-be that this shoebox is her one place that he can never look at it or even think about it. And so he proceeded to forget about it. But here it is more than 60 years later, and she had become sick and went to the doctor, and the doctor said, I don't really know if she's going to recover. And so this little old man, he's trying to get things in order, and so he pulls down the shoebox from up there on the shelf, and he brings it to his beloved and says, you know, is it time that we look at this? And she said, yeah, it's okay. You can look in there. And so he opens it up, and he finds two beautifully handcrafted doilies and more than $25,000. And he said, what's this? And she said, those doilies, when I got married, my grandmother told me that I should never argue with my husband. If I ever get really angry, just go crochet a doily. And so he looked at those two doilies, and he just like almost began to cry. He was so moved to tears that in more than 60 years, that only twice had she ever got upset with him. And he said, and what about all this cash? He said, oh, well, that's from all the doilies that I sold. Yeah. You get to decide what you're going to do with what's going on in the circumstances in your life. You know, it's your choice. You know, you get to make that decision. What am I going to do with what has happened here? You know, Gandhi, he said that I refuse to allow anybody to walk through my mind with dirty feet. Is that great? I'm not going to let anybody walk through my mind with dirty feet, with whatever junk that somebody wants to dump my way or throw my way, or I'm just not going to let it in my mind. I mean, what a powerful place to be. I mean, I was coming back on the plane, you know, last week and from Montana, and it's like half the plane seemed to be coughing and sneezing. Like, the guy next to me, every 2 minutes, he'd start coughing, and then you know, kind of, then he'd blow his nose, and the person behind me was just coughing. It's like, I could just envision these projectiles, like, no. It was like, really, and then coughing across, and cough up and down the rows, and all these things. You know, I don't know what was going on this, probably a medevac or something, but, and so, you know, naturally, okay, I got to heal this guy who's next to me, and so, you know, I'm sending good juju, you know, good vibes, heal, wholeness, all that stuff, and then it says, Christian, no, you know, you don't heal anything. You don't send your prayers or your thoughts everywhere. You talk, send a good thought. Well, I'm sending a good thought. I'm sending a good thought to make a bad thing better. It means I believe that there's a bad thing I need to make better. So, okay, I'm just going to protect myself. I'm going to put myself in this beautiful white light and this orb. You know. But I'm protecting myself from what? You know, that's the thing. I'm protecting myself from all the coughing, the heck and sneezing, or whatever you want to call that junk. No. You know, I'm reading Goldsmith, getting ready for you guys. So I'm getting my head in this absolute realm, and I just got to realize, I need to be wholeness. I need to be the health, the perfection, the well-being, and that is what I am. And as I am that which I am begins to emanate out. That is the countenance of my being. That is the ripple effect that is going out to the plane. That is the light, the vibration, and the frequency that surrounds me. It's not combating anything. It is allowing the thing itself to shine in the midst of who I am in that moment. I'm healthy. But, you know, the thing is, we don't combat anything. You just got to have the faith. You know, Dr. Martin Luther King, who we're celebrating his birthday this week, said faith is taking that first step when you cannot see the whole stairway. Man, is that great? I'm going to take this first step even if I can't see the whole path. Because I'll tell you what, you want those circumstances to change in your life, you may have to let go of the path you think you should be on so the divine path can begin to lead you forward, that the thing itself can begin to show this light for you to be willing to step out into it, even if it's beyond what you think is possible. I mean, a great example this week. Trevor, my beloved Callie's and my son turned 18 this week, and what a journey. I mean, I can remember when we first came home from the hospital, the Holders, Ray and Carolyn, had somehow got into our house over in Del Mar, probably because we never locked the door, but, you know, and they put up Welcome Home Trevor and balloons, and this little guy started into this life welcomed by you guys, this spiritual community, and to this day, I know that's the foundation which he is brought into life, and so he is an amazing manifester. And so he was all boy, still is all boy, loving transportation like all little boys do. And so early on, you know, taxis, he wants to ride in a taxi, no problem with taking him for a taxi ride. Then he's a little bigger, he wants a fire truck ride. You know, so for his birthday, we get him a fire truck ride. And then he wants to be on a boat, you know, so for his birthday, we take, you know, the Coronado Ferry, no problem, or take him on a cruise, no problem. But then as he gets a little older, he wants a private limousine, you know. It's like, I don't know, Trev. And then we have Bing Bush, who's a lawyer here at Seaside, who like handled the social aspect of the Breeders' Cup. He said, hey, Christian, I got a limo. You want us to arrange a ride for Trevor's birthday? It's like, you're kidding me. That little smart manifester, man. He was able to. And now if limos aren't enough, now he wants the skies, right? He wants to fly. So we've got a wonderful member here at Seaside, Jim Coleman, who flies his own little Cessna. And say, hey, you know, you want me to give Trevor a ride for his birthday? It's like, you're kidding me. And so he gets to ride around San Diego Bay just having a glorious time. And all of a sudden, Trevor, who loves flying, has decided he doesn't want to fly commercial flights anymore because there may be babies at airports. Like, duh, yeah, there's got to be babies there. But he's creating these issues. So all he wants now is to fly on a private jet. I said, you know, I don't think this one's going to happen, Trevor. You know, it's like... You know, yeah, it's you're on your own here, Trev. You know, dreamland tonight, no problem. You know, Trevor, yeah, I want to fly a private jet. I don't think so, Trevor. You know, but, you know, you can create whatever you want. You know, private debt, dad, mom. Yeah, someday, yes, someday you'll fly in a private jet. He's sitting in the office last Sunday. James Kaplan, who's going to miss the first foundation class, comes into my office to get a foundation class curriculum. And he's talking to Trevor, and we find out he's a corporate pilot. And he says, you know, I'm going to be down at the airport. You know, we can't fly people. I mean, it's, you know, it's not our plane. I fly for the guys. But he can come down and he can sit on there. You know, he can turn on the motor. He can see the panels, everything light up. And if that little bugger doesn't get down to that plane with a big happy birthday on the side of the plane. You know, Marv, you want to put that up there? And he gets down there and he's sitting in his private jet. And James says, you know what? We checked with the owner. We've never said yes, but you know what? We can take him for a flight around. And so next slide, there goes Trevor. So I share that because I don't want your dreams to be diminished by a mind that doesn't believe, because with spirit, all things are possible. The thing itself is infinite. It can show up with anything, everything. I mean, Trevor continued to get the magazines. He'd go to the pilot's lounges for a couple years, pulling out these executive jet magazines, saying, yeah. And when he got there, he said, there's my Gulfstream 100. It's like, how'd you know what that is? But, you know, he was so seeing it in his mind that the thing itself began to take the shape of the mold in which he had created. And that's what we want to do, is create a mold. But what happens is we get caught up when life starts working, protecting what it is we have. You see it happen in the corporate world all the time. One of the biggest challenges in the corporate world is that they protect what it is they have, and they don't want to make a mistake. And one of the greatest mistakes is not doing anything. Where Facebook encourages their guys to go fast because it's a rapidly changing kind of world, and to break things. Now, it's not because Mark Zuckerberg thinks that, you know, is reckless and breaking things is good, but he's well aware that you got to make a lot of mistakes on the way to create things. But some of the big corporate conglomerates that have a lot going for them it's difficult for them to move. I've been reading Steve Chase's book, and he is a co-founder of AOL, you know, and it's called The Third Wave. The first wave was the creation of internet. That was Cisco, Sun, Sprint, AOL. Second generation was the apps. That's Facebook, Google, WhatsApp. Those things. And the third generation is the utilization of the apps for the entrepreneurs to create something that disrupts the big conglomerates. And so something, let's say, like the concept of self-driving cars. You know, spirit is infinite in its wisdom. And, you know, Google and Uber is very excited about the self-driving cars. But do you realize that the self-driving vehicles didn't get started in the tech industry? It started with John Deere Tractors, who's a 200-year-old agricultural corporation, and their thinking was, if we could get these tractors to go on GPS, that would be just fine. And so they created the self-driving tractors years and years ago, more than 20 years ago, before Google was ever founded. But their corporate think wasn't such, how can we extrapolate this into self-driving vehicles for the masses? Now, what's happening in the third wave is there's partnership. Had they licensed out that knowledge, had they partnered with a tech company, had they, you know, sold the right, they would be on that leading front. But sometimes we get so comfortable not wanting to make a mistake that we're not willing to try something new and different. We saw it happen with Kodak, right? 1975, Steven Sasson came to Kodak, who was working for them in development, and said, hey, digital cameras, man, this is the way the future is going. They said, how long is it going to be before it's really going to be on par with, you know, film? He said, maybe 20 years. Well, you got a bunch of old guys sitting on the board who aren't going to be around in 18, 20 years. They said, no problem. So in 2012, they filed bankruptcy. They were the first to have the digital cameras, and they didn't do anything with that. And so what is happening in this era with the thing itself is it's manifesting in ways like Uber, and it disrupts the whole taxi industry. But unless you get on board to do something new, it may end up disrupting, you know, FedEx and UPS and all those other things. And so, like Jeff Bezos of Amazon says, you know, I know that Amazon's going to be disrupted someday, and it's not going to come as a surprise, and I'm just ready that will happen. Steve Jobs said, you got to be willing to cannibalize yourself or someone else will. It's like, what does that mean? Remember the iPods? Man, that was the revolution in music. But they gobbled themselves up and came out with the iPhone. And the iPods, which once led to market sales, is no longer part of that. Or the iPad has cannibalized the MacBooks. You know, they've got it. Anyways, you've got to be willing to make a mistake and do something and stretch and grow. Amazon knew it. They came into the market. Their success, their reputation, and their revenue was based upon the printed book. And they were the one to first say, you know what? It's going technology, and we are going to develop the technology and deliver that. And so I share this because I want us to get that spirit is constantly emerging in new ways. And we can say, oh, it's not going to affect me. It's not going to bother. And, you know, things are going to come up and show up. You know, AI, that artificial intelligence, I don't even want to talk about that kind of stuff. Anybody use Siri? That's called AI. You know, that's artificial intelligence that is working with you. You know what the biggest holiday sales item was this year? Sold tens of millions of dollars. It was Amazon's Echo. That's right. It's Alexa that is giving Siri a run. You set up this little hockey puck in your house, and it just listens to you all the time. Personally, I don't like that. But you know what? Hey, play some jazz music. I want to hear more Carissa. Boom, on it comes. Hey, what is the weather like outside? You don't even have to open your door. You don't even have to get out of your climate-controlled environment. You can find out if it's hot or cold outside. What's the traffic like? You just speak it. I want you to realize that this intelligence is showing up already, and you can refuse to play. But it was the number one seller in this holiday season. Tens of millions of dollars were spent on this. And so things are progressing, and the thing itself doesn't disappear. It reemerges. It takes new form. And we can say, oh, isn't that terrible? Or we can begin to recognize, like the chalice, the Holy Grail. First question is, you know, what is this? How is spirit here? You know, who does it serve? How is God showing up here? I got to tell you, with the self-driving cars, you're never going to get me in one, I don't think. But I got to tell you, Trevor, who will never be driving on his own probably, will love the self-driving cars. He's learning to talk to Siri right now. He's learning articulation because she doesn't respond unless he gets it right. You know, things begin to emerge in the world. That's his best new friend. And so as we begin to open up to the spirit, we've got to recognize one of the things that Ernest Holmes tells us, that is, you know, when something doesn't seem right, you got to be clear that it's not something and God. You want to get rid of the challenge. You want to get rid of the evil. You got to get rid of a belief in two things. Get rid of the dualistic belief that there could be God in this situation, that I need to heal this cough that is next to me. No, I need to be God expressing in this moment. I've got this fear of artificial intelligence. No, I got to be God expressing in this moment. There's no exception here. I've got to recognize that as I move to that place and begin to move myself to that God realization, which is the first step of overcoming any situation, is recognize that love and that life and that power and that perfection, that first cause, that first breath, that wonderful cause factor, that infinite intelligence, that wisdom that is moving through me. And as I am lifted to that place, I recognize the evil or the challenge, the circumstance that needs to be redefined is just part of the collective belief or the cardinal mind. And the cardinal mind is not God ordained. It doesn't have the laws to support it. It doesn't have the principle behind that. You know, Ernest Holmes says that evil, or the challenge, or call it what you want, is not a person, place, or thing of itself. We got to depersonalizing our problem, saying he, she, that. What I got to do is go back to remember that presence of God that is right here, right now. Ernest Holmes, from this chapter, he writes on page 33, paragraph 33, for all you textbook toad metaphysicians here today. He said that there never was a cosmic famine. God is always God, no matter what our emotional storm or what our objective situation may be. There is always a something hidden in the innermost being that has never been violated. Oh, we may stumble, but always there is this eternal voice that is forever whispering in our ear that the thing which causes the internal quest, that thing which forever sings and sings and sings. There's a part of you, no matter how bad something was, has never been violated. That's what you need to bring forth. You may be stuck on the side of the threshold or the doorway, but you need to get across it and recognize that in the midst of everything, that presence and that infinite wisdom is there. I remember a story from my childhood of hearing of an ocean liner in the North Atlantic, in the middle of one of those horrific North Atlantic winter storms, where it's the perfect storm, where you know the waves are enormous, the skies are torrential, and the waves are just battling this ship from side to side. It is rocking, it is creaking, it is having its challenge, and the people have gathered in the salon, which it later came to realize probably the saloon, but as a kid, salon is appropriate, and they're just sitting there with absolute fear, with sure that they are going to die, and the captain comes into the midst of the people and says, I want you to know about the ship, that it is a sturdy ship, that it has been built strong, that it has weathered many storms in the past, that the engines on this ship are excellent, they are in great shape, and this ship has been through many storms like this and even worse. So I want you to be able to put your faith in this ship and in God and know that everything is going to be okay. Martin Luther King says faith is taking that first step when you can't see the whole stairwell. And we need you to put your faith in this because it's gone through it many times. Well, in the times of challenges and storms in our life, are we able to remember to calm down enough and say, okay, God, life, spirit, divine, essence, thing itself, call it what you want. Oh, man, I need you to talk. I need to hear that reassurance that, you know what, you've been through this before. You've been through a lot of tougher things than I'm experiencing right now, and I need to know that you've come through this, or this life has come through this, and I'm going to come through this. I'm going to trust that. I'm going to have faith. Doesn't matter what the doctors say. I know that healing is possible. I've heard of almost any condition in my 35 years, horrendous ones, and it seems as if everyone I could ever think of that I've heard of, I've heard some kind of perfect healing of that situation that just mesmerizes the doctors. I know with an unshakable conviction that healing of anything is possible, whether it's in the physical form, whether it is of tumors, whether it's bones or relationships or finances. I've watched amazing, amazing stories happen, but you got to feel the love. You got to feel that presence as well. How I started this morning, it's not the word God. It is that vibration, it is that frequency, it is that divine essence from which I came that breathed me into expression. That is what I have to return to and allow that to emanate and to do its thing. It knows how to guide the galaxy by all means. It knows how to take care of this body of mine. I got to get myself out of the way and allow it to do its thing. Did you guys hear that little girl this last week? 8-year-old Bridget Kelly. She had this cancer and she was home for more than 15 or more than a year, and her concern was that her friends weren't going to remember her. Well, here's, I think, the beginning of the year, going back to school.
If a passerby wondered why this crowd huddled together in the bitter cold outside Marymount Elementary School in Quincy, the signs said it all.
It was an awesome display by our whole community coming out for us, so it was really exciting.
We didn't even notice the cold this morning.
On what can be the toughest morning to head back to class, 8-year-old Bridget Kelly was elated. After missing more than 15 months of school while she battled acute lymphoblastic leukemia,
Bridget!
She was a fist-raising pink ray of sunshine.
Yeah, Bridget!
The first night she had to stay in the hospital, the first thing she said she was upset about was missing school. So this could not be more exciting for her.
That was done. That was awesome.
And with a kiss from mom as she headed into third grade, it was clear the first lesson of this new year had been about love.
All things are possible when you know. And I look at that amazing story of healing of her physical body and how the thing itself showed up. But what I would think is really amazing about that story and how the thing itself showed up was in the love that surrounded her and all the people and all the friends that came out in support of this little girl. See, the love is what heals. Love is the conduit through which that thing itself shows up in our life. Yes, the physical body heals, but the miracle is the love that when you begin to feel it, you begin to sense it. You can be 8 years old and not even know how this stuff works, but if you are open to the love that is available to you now, healing happens, and it can be that simple. Ernest Holmes, in the last paragraph of this first chapter of his book, The Science of Mind, he says, if you find something difficult to grasp, it will be difficult to grasp because you think it's incomprehensible. For the mind that is within you is the mind that is within everything. That is the thing itself. And let it be that simple. So my challenge to you this week is to recognize that mind that is within you is that mind that is within everything. And let it be that simple. God bless us all. Hey, keep it going as we bring back to the stage Carissa Schrader. And Carissa has got this amazing love song to God. So open your hearts. Be ready to be touched.
Close one, my door. Thank you.
That is Carissa Schrader. Woo! Finally debuting at Seaside. We've been waiting for you. Carissa! Woo! Oh my, fabulous. That is just, it is absolutely, it is just so good. Hey, this is the time of our service where we have the opportunity to share our gift, to give our love in a sense of support of what's going on here at Seaside. Your gift makes a difference to keep what is going on here at Seaside going on. You know, every Sunday for the last 30 years, we're entering our 30-year anniversary this year. We have paused at this moment and said, hey, we need to support God's work together. And as we continue to just regularly and systematically remember God first in our life, what happens is Spirit shows up first in our life in all situations. And so as we continue to allow that Spirit to flow through us, we find it supporting its work as our life. And so I invite you to listen to your heart and your soul and to give from that place of the caring and the love, that vibration that you have going on today, the music, the message, the sense of family. That's what we're about. And that's a result of this moment, all of us saying, you know what? Gosh, I support Spirit's expression at Seaside. So with that, I want to invite our ushers to come forward to say and say thank you to this wonderful crew. Thank you to those who mail in your contributions. When you can't be here on a Sunday, it is greatly appreciated, as well as those that remember us with the auto tithe, that regular systematic support from your world into Seaside's. That regular systematic flow makes it a lot more comfortable for us to be able to operate, because where we pay the bills, they like theirs on a regular basis from us. So that's important. And you guys at home, thank you. We are receiving more mail and more support from you than ever before. So I just want to say thank you to those that are watching in Virginia, those in Sacramento, those that are in Minnesota, those that are in Florida, those that are in New York, and just continue to receive wonderful expressions of love. So we know you're there, and we hold you in our prayers and our love. And so with all this said, I'm going to pray. So I invite you to join with me in this wonderful place in the heart and the soul as I stand here sharing this prayer of gratitude with the most generous of spiritual communities, knowing that this truly is a divine moment where that divine download of abundance flows through each and every one of us. We are that conduit, that channel through which it moves forth. And as the Spirit moves, it brings with it a deeper sense of peace around our finances. It brings a deeper sense of security because we are playing with that which is infinite, this infinite reservoir in which we are that channel through which it flows. And I know right now that we are not caught up with fear that our good depends upon a person, an employer, or somebody outside, but rather it is that wellspring that is within that pours forth. And so we take that which has shown up in our life and has blessed us, and we send it forth knowing it brings the blessings and joy to everyone it comes in contact. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this opportunity to recognize that which is life blessing me, I can share with others. I move from a sense of consciousness, thinking I can do something or believing, to being the expressor, the action, taking the belief and putting it into action. It allows me to be that conduit for it to continue to manifest greater good. And so it is. Amen. Together, let us say this affirmation of abundance, which is, Spirit continues to bless my world. Gratefully, I live as the giving expression of Spirit, opening the floodgates of the affluent flow of greater good as my life now. Thank you. four guys from Seaside. And so as I stand before this bounty, I can feel the love and the presence that has flowed through each and every one of us. For that divine presence of God has moved through our very life and our very experience and has just inspired our actions of support. And so this is given in love. It is received in love. It is handled in good stewardship. And it's put forth back into life, bringing the joy and the blessings and the grace and the good to everyone it comes in contact, because that is where it has come from. So thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this opportunity to pause and to practice these actions of truth. And so it is. Amen. All right. This is Edwin Robinson. He is your board president. And not only a wonderful organizer, he moved all the chairs in the sanctuary out this week, and Malcolm spent several days here meticulously, amazingly, taking every spot out of this carpet. It is fabulous. I've never seen it this clean since Robin had it put in. And then he said, you know what, I can clean your chairs too. So this week he's coming back to make sure we have sparkling chairs. So we are very, very excited about it. Malcolm, thank you for your wonderful expression. Speaking of thank yous, Carissa, oh my goodness, you just rocked us and touched our soul. Where have you been all our life? It is fabulous. So if you want more Carissa, next Saturday afternoon, the SD Heritage Society got a wonderful concert going on. Speaking of concerts, I'm glad you got in from yours last night. You were out very late, but we don't talk about that in public. And just always appreciate you driving in from Ramona, leaving your kids so you can be with your spiritual family. Danielle Tucker, just rocking San Diego all the time. Dr. Christina, just inspiring us with wonderful words and prayers. Thank you for your consciousness. Giving us sound today is Matthew. Giving us the visual is Marv. And a big shout out to the Crawfords and their wonderful team that takes six individuals to help produce a Sunday morning. So we're grateful to that. And so if any of you are interested in being part of that production team, see me or see the Crawfords. You can be behind the camera, or they could use some help with the social media. It is definitely, we're asking for help at this time. So if you can help us with that, that would be great. Also asking for help. You know what? I need help with making sure our family room looks good on a Sunday morning. And also, if there's somebody who wants to watch over our hospitality table. I mean, we set everything up, but sometimes it gets messy, and we're family. We're okay with messes, but that's the first thing our guests see as they walk in the door. Have you noticed that? That hospitality table. So if somebody wants to help out with hospitality, talk to me. Somebody wants to take the organization of our family room, keeping that looking good, and the tables organized, and working with ministries, good luck. We could really use that support, as well as answering phones during the week. I can go on. But together we have been able to create Seaside, and together we do wonderful things. Classes are starting this week, so get involved, sign up for class, be in Foundations on Tuesday nights with me if you want to hear about the basics. You heard what last week's was about. It was about spirit. Or Thursday nights with Dr. Kathy Hearn, as she looks at some of the writings of Ernest Holmes, or some of the enrichment classes that are going on. There's just a lot of good that is happening here at Seaside. Take advantage of it. The men are getting together next Saturday morning for the men's breakfast. They go over an article from the Science of Mind magazine, always a powerful kind of experience for sure. Saturday morning, women. Many of you last year went on the Women's March. There's an annual Women's March around the country. Last year it happened to coincide with the election, and there were more than 5 million women marching in solidarity around the planet. And San Diego went Richter. It went off the charts with the amount of women showing up. And again, this year, the annual one, they're marching. And this year, Cali has rented a bus. There's 55 seats. I think there's only a dozen left. And so she's pointing people to go to PayPal. The next people will go to 12 that go to PayPal get the last 12 seats. But they're marching in honor of the Seaside women, marching in honor of Sandy Atkinson, who for her lifetime in San Diego has been on the leading edge of feminine activism, has really been a mentor to many of the women in San Diego, and particularly here at Seaside, has got Seaside going green and doing crazy things like solar and composting and women's rights and all that. She's unable to march with them this week because of some physical challenges, and so they are holding her in consciousness and dedicating the Seaside March to her. but joining the women around our country, if not the planet, in solidarity for equal rights, for social and environmental justice, to get out there and vote in the next season is the big thing. So that's Saturday. If you want to walk with the women, that's what's going on around here. And there's a lot going on. So take a look at the Sunday program. My head's not grasping. One other thing I wanted to talk about, I may get it, but most important are you guys. Anybody want to share this morning? Yeah.
Raise it high so everyone can see it.
You're shy. Too shy to say anything?
Do you want to say something, Ryan?
Well, here we are in, up in the kids area. We're about Martin Luther King Day, sharing how Martin Luther King have equality between white and black people, bringing them together because everyone, no matter what kind of skin they are, they're always the same, no matter what.
Beautiful. Wow. Woo. And this is why we have a growing and expanding youth program. We have four teens at camp this week. So it's just this wonderful things are going on there. So if you've got kids or if your kids have kids or you got grandkids, bring them to Seaside because we give them that sense of self-worthiness and teach them the truth of their being, that they have a gift to bring this world. And so let's say together that we support them in this. Together, we see you, we love you, and we support you in your magnificence. So with that, let us pray. I want to invite any of our religious science practitioners to stand and all of us who feel that upliftment of that divine energy. For there is a life force that is moving in this sanctuary. Just pause and feel it. Feel that special essence that Katie brought us into in prayer here today. When she stood, you could just feel a consciousness that transforms. There is a life force. It is God. It is life. It is intelligence. It is joy. It is wholeness. It is abundance. It is the well-being that just emanates from the center of your being. For there's only one that is spirit that expresses in many different ways. It is the unity and multiplicity. It is the very life of one's being. It is the presence of God that moves in this moment. Feel and sense it. And that's something that is beyond words. It is real. It is right. It is divine. It is the thing itself. And come to know that you are of that thing. You are the part of that perfection and that wholeness, that first cause, that essence, that wisdom, that intelligence. All that spirit is, I am, you are. That is the truth. Feel it. Sense it. You got it? Do you feel that? For I know right now that the spirit responds to that kind of activation, to that kind of realization. For that intelligence that guides all things is the same wisdom that is there at the very core of your being, is the thing itself that is seeking to express that which is perfect, whole, and right for your next step in your self-expression. So with a sense of joy, I know that I'm able to step into life as it is emerging forward and not get caught up and say, this is bad, this is terrible, this is evil. This evolution that is happening, I'm able to look and to see the presence of the divine in the midst, whether it is self-driving cars or the Echo and Alexa. God's there. Spirit is there. Because spirit is everywhere. It is omnipresent. And as I am experiencing a challenge, and if you are experiencing one in your life somewhere, or someone you love is stuck in that place, lift into this light, into this wholeness, this divine idea. Take that challenge and let it go to that which guides all things, and it becomes the emergence of that expression. You begin to bring forth a new frequency as you move within a new resonant field of wholeness. And anything unlike it just can't match that vibration, and it falls away, not because it's a battle, not because I'm trying to send good vibes or stop a cough, but because I am spirit emerging and expressing in this moment, and anything unlike it cannot remain. And so it emerges for each and every one of this spiritual community, every member of this family, every guest and friend of this wonderful spiritual family is a sense of wholeness and a greater conscious connection with that infinite source that brings forth the light in those particular ways that fills those ever greater molds of possible creation in our life. And we are able to bring the love of life to all situations. I'm grateful to know that I'm the one who is free of the circumstances, that I am the one who is observing myself in the circumstances. And it's from this observational perspective, I am free enough to choose the wholeness and the wellness and the next great choice for my step in my life. And I become that place where the divine download has its way. And I am grateful to be that here and now. And with that comes the wonder, with that comes the abundance, the prosperity, the joy, the passion and relationships, the intimacy, the honesty, the joy, the love, the good, the God. And so I say thank you, not to anyone or anything, because there's nothing outside. I live in that state of appreciation and gratitude. I live in that state of grace where Spirit has its way, and I allow it to be my way. So I let go of this. I trust this. I believe in this divine expression that it is the truth. And so it is. Amen.
There was a time in my life I thought I had to do it all for myself. I didn't know the grace of God was sufficient. I didn't know the love of God was at hand. But now I can say, if you are discouraged, struggling just to make it through another day, you've got to let it go. And this is what you've got to say: I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life and my with my faith, I see the light. I am free in the Spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. Come on, Seaside, sing it out. Yes, I'm only here for God, yeah.
Wow. Hey, our affirmation for the week is, I see Spirit in all of life. Together, I see Spirit in all of life. Touch your heart and say it again. I see Spirit in all of life. One more time. I see Spirit in all of life. Can also be is all of life, but I like to end better. So anyway, join us for the grace song.
I'm living in love. I'm living in peace. I'm living my life for what I believe, through joys and through fears. In this world I walk, God's grace shines on me, and it shines on us all. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We are living. As one family, we honor all truth. As together we walk, God's grace moves through me, and it moves through us all. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We are living in grace.
a great week, Seaside.